Developers may not like to hear this, but I think Devin can probably code as well as us, if not better. Business owners, you may not like to hear this, but I don't think you'll be replacing us with Devin anytime soon. Here's why. In this video, I'll be sharing why I think Devin is a developer tool and not a replacement yet. I read the Cognition Labs blog post on Devin and immediately shat my pants. This is the list of Devin's claimed capabilities. Learn how to use unfamiliar technologies, end-to-end app building and deployment, autonomous code-based debugging, AI model training, help solve open source software issues, enhance existing software, and a really weird flex, but it can also steal gigs from broke Upwork developers. I say claimed because Devin hasn't been officially released. And startups that are hungry for venture capital aren't the most reliable at describing themselves. To be fair, every capability does come with a video clip showing Devin doing as claimed. I wonder how many takes it took to get it right. But so what? Humans also make mistakes and learn. Sometimes we don't even learn. I doubt Devin will be released with a 5% success rate, as much as some would love that. And so, if I was asked for my professional opinion of Devin, just from a coding perspective, if all the claims are accurate, Devin looks like it can code really f***ing well. So I was tickled when I watched the videos by developers downplaying Devin's capabilities. They open GitHub repositories, look at lines of codes, criticize data samples, and conclude that Devin is not an elite level developer. And other developers in the comments interpret that as, yeah, Devin sucks. And I find this argument a bit flat, right? Peter Griffin?
I agree as well.
If Devin really can do all this, can we just accept that that puts it close to senior dev level? Even if it falls slightly below that, that's still really good. Why even question it and turn this into a who can code better debate? Business stakeholders really only care about coding if they think it affects software quality. They're right, it does. But does it make sense when I say your code could be flawless, but your product could still be dog and nobody wants it? And a product that people can't get enough of could be powered by a plate of spaghetti? Fix a WordPress. Anyways, developers don't code just to code. We build products, solutions. Hopes and dreams, baby. Hopes and dreams. And these solutions and products just happen to be made of code. So I give you a hypothetical situation. A team of developers is involved in a new project or an existing project that needs regular updates and maintenance with the occasional new feature. Suddenly, Devin comes in and says, "Hey there, noobs. I'm taking over all the coding from now on. Can you safely fire us?" Not just you, every company in the world, can they just fire all their developers and expect products to still get built and maintained to the same level of enterprise level solution? No chance. I said at the start that business owners and decision makers won't like to hear this. Yes, cutting down your development team headcount can lower overheads significantly. Quality here being how well it solves user problems. Those gaps in between code and users and solution? That's where good developers lie. That's where we, I'm including myself, that's where we add value. And that's why you might want to keep us around. So what exactly do we do in these gaps? Number one, requirements gathering. Even before a single line of code is written, a development team will extract the needs and requirements of a solution. And it's not always an easy conversation to have. You remember those dementors from Harry Potter that suck out people's souls? We don't just ask you what a stakeholder wants, then say, "Okay, master," and we go build it. Instead, we keep probing you to check whether this is really the problem you need to solve. Number two, user testing. I'm not talking about code review, I'm talking about taking a feature and sitting down with users and explaining the feature, getting the users to test it out, asking users for feedback, asking for their satisfaction level, and evaluating said feedback before implementing it. That last part is really important. You don't want to just give users what they say they want. Yes, their feedback is essential, but sometimes they don't really know what they want. And sometimes they might want it, but they're only going to use it once a year. Number three, industry compliance. Countries have laws. Different countries have different laws. Tax laws, audit laws, data management laws, cybersecurity laws. When a business decides they are going to build a software solution that targets certain industries, like banking, accounting, legal services, medical services, or education, you'll have to make sure your software follows the law of the country you're in. For example, in Malaysia, where I'm from, if you build a finance app and collect customer data, it can't be sent overseas. It has to stay within Malaysia, and often the founders or owners need to house it in on-site service. Devin might beat me at coding, but he will never beat Adrian Ching at bagging internet strangers. So what I'm trying to say is, please subscribe. Back to our hypothetical situation. So you have Devin that codes like a wizard. How does a business make the most of this? As I showed above, a development team doesn't just sit and code away when they build and maintain software products. So in my humble opinion, the best thing a business can do is to ask its development team to learn how to use Devin and incorporate it into the workflow. Actually, let's forget about the humble part. Listen to me, business owners. Make it clear you're not trying to replace your people. You're trying to upskill them for the sake of the business. That's how you get motivated and engaged people who can give you the best of both worlds. Any coding, Devin handles initially, and a developer steps in to review or fill in the gaps, giving you better solutions and product market fit. Quality and speed, no compromise. And fine, you might be able to downsize your development team a bit. That one guy who doesn't shower and didn't wish you a happy birthday is out of here. But replace an entire team? No way. I'm sure many will try, but my team and I will still be here, as will all the other good developers.
There are dozens of us. Dozens!
Because there will always be clients who understand or learn the hard way that coding isn't everything when building a software product. And developers, hurry up and go through your 6 stages of grief. If all you offer as a developer is coding and nothing else, you don't take an interest in the client's business, you don't speak up when there's a better way to do things, you don't practice your soft skills and kiss a little ass, all you want to do is get instructions and code, sounds like what a tool does. If you behave like a tool, people see you as a tool, and tools are a lot easier to replace. I'm both a developer and a business owner, so I see both sides here. Say my team just carried out instructions like robots, never offered opinions, never corrected me when they knew I was wrong, or never had a Nintendo all-nighter. If I had the option to replace them with something just as blindly obedient and significantly cheaper, I'll be dumb not to. But my team of developers and designers and project managers do all those things. We disagree and work towards better solutions. And there's no way I could just replace them with Devin or today's AI and get the same results. And if I'm wrong, then any day now, we should expect the Cognition Labs team to fire all their developers and just get Devin to build and iterate itself. And you'll just be as good. If that really happens, I'll run naked through the streets of Kuala Lumpur. Stop blaming AI for being as good as you. Be better. After all that talk about how good developers help business owners solve problems, I'm not gonna just leave you hanging. The whole reason a business would want to move to Devin is because of cost. But as I said earlier, what is the point of paying less if it means significant compromises to the product? So instead of outsourcing to Devin, consider outsourcing to an overseas development team. If you hire right, you can get excellent skill, talent, and work ethic at a significantly more affordable price point. I'll say this. If an offshore team scares you, don't even think of an AI team. So how do you hire an offshore team properly? Check out my video on this exact topic. I go into the key factors that should inform your choice and how to manage a team from halfway across the world. Spoilers? You don't. Anyways, as far as this whole Devin topic is concerned, Devin is a good code assistant, and we might incorporate it into our toolset if and when the time is right and it doesn't turn out to be a scam or something. Hope you enjoyed this video. Please subscribe, leave a like, comment, and let's see how to manage offshore development teams.